you for coming to the 24th season of the Congressional Biomedical Research Caucus presentations. I'm Joan Goldberg. I'm Executive Director of the American Society for Cell Biology, and we help the Coalition for the Life Sciences and the caucus co-chairs. I want to thank the co-chairs of the caucus, Representative Brian Bilbray from California and his staff, Representative Charlie Dent from Pennsylvania, Jackie Speer from California, and Rush Holt from New Jersey, all for their commitment and their dedication and ongoing support of this caucus. And just to remind you, or for those for whom this is their first time, we do videotape every one of these briefings, and you can see past briefings on our website at www.coalitionforlifesciences.org. This one, too, will be provided there, and you can also register for the RSS feed to be alerted to future postings. But today we'll be hearing from Dr. Johanna Wysocka, Assistant Professor, Department of Chemical and Systems Biology and Department of Developmental Biology at Stanford University. She'll discuss how recent progress in the burgeoning and relatively new field of epigenomics allows scientists to annotate on an unprecedented scale and with high resolution portions of our genome that are responsible for the unique regulation of genes in a cell. Epigenomics is a study of factors that control the functions of genes, including the biochemical networks and linkages. And I assure you, we'll hear a much better definition and explanation from our presenter. Epi, by the way, comes from the Greek word for over or about, and this will help us understand about normal development and human disease in the cell. Dr. Wysocka was born in Poland and moved to the United States for her doctoral studies at the Cold Spring Harbor Lab in New York. And since receiving her Ph.D. degree in 2003, she's done postdoc training in chromatin biology at the Rockefeller University in New York. In the fall of 2006, she established her independent research group at Stanford. And her current research is focused on the epigenetic control of development, with particular emphasis on the gene regulation in stem cell renewal and differentiation. She's received numerous awards for her work, including the Searle Scholar Award, the Baxter Award, the Terman Fellow Award, the California Institute for Regenerative Medicine New Faculty Award, and the W.M. Keck Foundation Distinguished Young Scholar Award. Last year, she was selected as recipient of the 2010 International Society for Stem Cell Research Outstanding Young Investigator Award in recognition of her group's unique contributions to the stem cell field. Dr. Wysocka has funding from NIH and from the California Institute for Regenerative Medicine, and please join me in welcoming her. I know she'll take questions after the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the introduction. It's a true pleasure to be here and tell you a little bit about our work, and in particular about early steps in making a structure that you are all very well familiar with and care about, a human face. But I also want you to leave this room with a little bit more understanding about what epigenomics can teach us about human development and disease. In the first part of my talk, I need to introduce you, or remind you at least, about some basic concepts such as morphogenesis, genomic regulatory elements, chromatin, epigenomic mapping. So I'll try to make it relatively painless, but please do stop me in the middle if you have questions. I don't want to lose you on the way. And in the second part, I will show you an example of how we can use this new technology of epigenomic mapping to annotate regulatory elements that are relevant for early steps in the formation of the human face. So just to state the obvious, human body is composed of tissues and organs, and tissues are built out of cells, different specialized cell types. And each cell contains nucleus in which our genetic information is packed in the form of DNA. And it's now a well-accepted fact in biology that all cells within an organism contain the same genome, the same genetic information. And that's the genome that we inherited from both our parents upon fertilization or formation of a human zygote. And in the absolutely fascinating process of development, this single cell, a zygote, is able to give rise to all the tissues and organs in the human body. So we have emergence of macroscopic form and function from a single cell in the developmental process. But this macroscopic form, of course, results from processes that occur on the cellular level. So emergence of form and function is associated with cellular processes such as proliferation. So cells divide, proliferate, allowing for organismal growth. Then we have migration, which allows cells to move around. We have adhesion, so that allows different cell types to sort away from each other. And we have differentiation, which allows for emergence of specialized cell types from stem cells and progenitors. So these are the main processes that shape morphogenesis during development. But I already told you that all cells within an organism have the same genome. So how come they have all these different properties, different migratory properties, different ability to proliferate, different differentiation state? So it's not that the genome differs, but the genomic interpretation differs. So for example, if you watch Bill O'Reilly and John Stewart, it's the same information, same news, but it's interpreted very, very differently. So here we have similar situation. Our cells interpret genomic information in different ways to give rise to an epigenome. So epi meaning exactly above or beyond genome. And I'll come back to the idea of what epigenomes really are. But for now, understand that one genome can give rise to many different epigenomes in the process of development. And as a consequence of these distinct interpretations of the genome, different cells express different genes. So for example, one cell will express or will turn certain sets of genes on and the other set of genes off. And in the other cell type, we'll have different sets of genes turned on and different sets of genes turned off. And it's not any single gene, but a combination or what we call a pattern of gene expression that determines functional properties of a given cell. And why is that? Because for the most part, these genes encode proteins. And you've heard through some of the earlier briefings that proteins are the main building blocks of our cells and the main workers. So we have different proteins in different cells, resulting in these different functional properties. But how is it that a given gene is expressed or not expressed at a given time in organism development, or in particular in human development? So we have specialized regions of the genome that we call genomic regulatory elements, such as enhancers, which control cell type specific gene expression. So what are these enhancers? There are compact specialized DNA regions, so compact, they're small. They are specialized because they're able to direct expression in particular tissue or cell type. For example, this enhancer will direct expression specifically in the forebrain. They're called enhancers because they enhance expression of target genes. They can act at a distance. This is very important. They're not necessarily located very close to the gene, but they can communicate with the gene at a long distance. And they mediate information relay between the genome and its environment through serving as landing pads for specific proteins and transcription factors that recognize these enhancers. But as a consequence of this type of regulation that we have specialized modules that direct expression in different tissues, distinct regions of the genome are utilized as enhancers in different tissues. In other words, one cell type's junk DNA is another cell type's treasure. So you've heard all about the junk DNA and that our genes constitute only 2% of our genome. 98% is something that we really don't know about. Why so much of this other stuff? Well, it turns out that if we have so many different cell types and these different cell types use different pieces of the genome for regulation, we need to have a lot of space to fit all the regulatory elements. And the piece of DNA that is going to be crucial, for example, of directing the expression of a given gene in the limb is not going to be important in a different cell type. And if you are a limb bud cell, you only care about this element for expression of your gene, but not about all these other elements. Now, understanding these pieces of DNA and which are important in which tissues are going to be absolutely critical for understanding human disease. And let me first illustrate this with an example. So here we have a developmentally important gene called sonic hedgehog. And if you have a mutations in coding part of this gene, this results in very severe malformations that affect multiple tissues and organs, including severe defects of the brain. But this gene is also important for development of limbs, where it's expressed from a very specific, where it's under regulation of a very specific enhancer, limb enhancer. And when you have mutations in the limb enhancer, it affects only the function of this gene in the limb. And as a result, if you delete this portion of DNA in the mouse, you have a mouse without limbs. And in humans, single point mutations, so single substitutions in the DNA pairs, result in malformations of the limbs. So more broadly, enhancer mutations can affect gene function in a specific tissue. Now, the first hint that these enhancers or mutations in regulatory regions are going to be much more important for disease than previously appreciated came from so-called genome-wide association studies. You probably heard about some of those studies, where essentially these are large-scale studies aimed at understanding what sequence variants, what genetic variants are associated with disease or determine predisposition for disease in humans, etc. And I think big expectation was that these variants are going to be within genes and we will have a linear relationship between perturbing gene function or resulting protein function and the disease. But it turned out that most of the sequence variants map not to genes, but instead to the non-coding parts of our genome. So not to those pieces of DNA that encode proteins, but away from them. So to many people, this was disappointing, although I would say, you know, it's not surprising. It's about the regulation, stupid. And this led to a compelling hypothesis that have been put forth that many, if not most, disease-linked genetic variants are, in fact, associated with genomic regulatory elements. So if you have these variants that affect enhancers or regulation of genes rather than genes themselves, it can result in human disease. So now we can say, well, if we can map these enhancers and we can map them in a genome-wide manner and a cell type-specific manner, maybe we will be able to understand why certain diseases and how certain diseases affect specific tissues. But there is a problem with that, which is that until recently, we had no good way to identify enhancers in a systematic and unbiased way. So why is that? They are small, they're embedded within the vast non-coding genomic space, they lack stereotypical DNA sequence composition, so that means it's not easy for us to look at the sequence of DNA and say, aha, here is an enhancer. And they have varied levels of sequence conservation. And this last point is important because while our genes are generally well conserved among different mammals or different related species, the enhancers are, we're learning more and more that they're not necessarily well conserved. So we really need to do studies directly in human cells if we want to understand human development and human disease. But I wouldn't be standing here if there were only problems. And an important clue to annotating regulatory elements, such as enhancers, lies in understanding how our DNA is organized and interpreted. In other words, how this one genome can give rise to many epigenomes in the developmental process. So it turns out that in the cell, our DNA is not naked, but instead is wrapped around twice around the proteins pool composed of proteins that we call histones. And together, this forms a basic unit of chromatin organization that is called the nucleosome. But DNA is long. We have about 2 meters of DNA packed in each cell. So of course, there are many spools that it wraps around to. And under electron microscope, it looks like beads on a string. So we call this structure beads on a string. And it turns out that these beads can be decorated by chemical tags. So chromatin undergoes reversible chemical modifications. And these modifications, these tags, have regulatory properties. They tag our genome for different functions. And some modifications, or combinations of this modification, bookmark genes for silencing. And other combinations of these modifications bookmark genes for activation. And this combinatorial regulation has been referred to as the histone code. So as most of this modification occurs on the protein component, the histones. So different combinations can bookmark our genes either for activation or for silencing. But important in the context of this talk is that not only genes are bookmarked, but also regulatory elements are bookmarked as well, and they're bookmarked when they're active. So for example, if this enhancer is active in the forebrain, it's going to be bookmarked, but not all these other regions. And the signature by which it is bookmarked is distinct from the signature that bookmarks either active or silent genes. So it's a unique signature, which we then can use to fish out this elements and characterize them in a cell type specific way. So the next few slides, I'm going to tell you about epigenomic mapping, how we can map the regulatory elements using these chromatin signatures in a genome-wide manner. So we take chromatin from given cell, we fragment it. So of course, it contains many different regions marked by many different signatures. But right now, we're interested in the signature that is associated with active enhancers in this tissue. So we add reagents, such as specific antibodies, that essentially we use them to fish out from the soup of all the different chromatin fragments. We're fishing out those that are going to be relevant to active enhancers. And then we isolate DNA, and we sequence it using high-throughput sequencing, getting millions and millions of reads. And these reads can then be annotated or aligned to the human genome. So we want to see where in the human genome those reads are, and we count them. So if a lot of reads are going to pile up over a given region, this suggests to us that enhancer, active enhancer was there. And we can do that across the genome. So we're fishing out now all active enhancers within the genome. And where are we going to get those peaks or piles of sequence reads? It means that the active enhancer was there. So this type of approach we call epigenomic mapping. And we can use it to annotate different features of human genomes, regulatory elements, active genes, silent genes, etc. So why is it important to annotate these regulatory elements? And particularly, why is it important to annotate those elements that are specific for cell types that only arise transiently during human development? So not necessarily are represented in an adult organism, but are only represented in the embryo while it develops. Well, turns out that we know much more about development of model organisms than we know about development of humans. And since many of these regulatory elements are not conserved in model organisms, it's really important for understanding human development that we annotate these elements in those developmentally important cell types. I already mentioned why it's important for human disease. We have probably a huge, unexplored space for non-coding regulatory mutations in human disease. It's also important for understanding where we're coming from. A lot of the evolution happens on regulatory elements. A lot of evolution happens not through tinkering with our coding sequences and tinkering with our proteins. A lot of it happens by tinkering with regulation, by just providing different regulatory combinations, which then allow for evolving new traits, new properties. So it's really important for understanding how we connect evolutionary with other organisms to study regulatory elements. And finally, it's also important for understanding human variation. You look around the room, we're all different. We look different. We behave differently. So where is this variation coming from? And a lot of it is not coming through differences in our proteins. It's coming through differences in regulation. And perhaps the most spectacular example of the individual variation is human face. And in the second part of my talk, I want to focus on some of our work on annotating regulatory elements that are involved in early steps in the formation of human face. But first, let me illustrate this process with a movie so you can appreciate how much morphogenetic movement goes into the formation of the face, how all these pieces come together, and now they're going to all come together to fit into the structure that finally resembles the human face. And you see how much movement, how much proliferation, migration, adhesion, differentiation has to go to this process for our face to arise during development. But if you want to understand the beginning of it, we have to go back even earlier, so even earlier than the start of this movie. And that is about 3 to 5 weeks of gestation in the human embryo, where a very important cell population forms. So at the very top of the neural tube, so the neural tube just closed, most of the neural tube will give rise to the central nervous system, so your brain, et cetera. But there, with certain exception, at the very top, there's a unique population specified that is called the neural crest. And these neural crest cells delaminate, so they peel off from the top of the neural tube and start migrating away. And this unique population is characterized by this very strong migratory potential. So the neural crest cells are able to migrate at very long distances. And they land in different portions of what will be our future face. And there they start maturing and differentiating. And another property of the neural crest cells is the amazing differentiation potential. So these cells can give rise to over 100 different cell types, roughly half of all the cell types that are represented in the human body. And they give rise to the majority of our face, so majority of our craniofacial bone and cartilage and the connective tissue, and also cranial nerves. It gives rise to the middle ear structure. This population also provides a very important contribution to the heart, makes almost all our peripheral nervous system, and makes almost all our pigmentation in the form of melanocytes. And because of this humongous contribution of the neural crest to the formation of the face. And I should say that neural crest is a relatively recent evolutionary invention. So it showed up in organisms such as vertebrates, mammals, reptiles, birds, fishes, etc. So it has thought to play a major role in evolution of vertebrates by facilitating adaptations to different environments and predatory lifestyle. So as you can appreciate from this amazing diversity of vertebrate faces, they are extremely plastic. The jaws, the feeding apparatus, was able to adapt really quickly to different environments, making us, as vertebrates, very successful evolutionary. By the way, do you know who this guy is?
Darwin.
Yes. Good, good. That's a relief. But neural crest also has a very high relevance for human disease. And the diseases that arise as a result of abnormal either formation or differentiation or migration of neural crest are called neurocrestopathies. And congenital neurocrestopathies are indeed among the most common congenital defects. And those include cleft lip and palate, one of the most common congenital malformations in humans, but also a variety of syndromes. And many of those syndromes include not only craniofacial abnormalities, but also heart defects and deafness, because these are also the two structures that are that neural crest very strongly contributes to. And some of the, I haven't listed them here, but some of the most aggressive cancers, such as melanoma and neuroblastoma, are also of neural crest origin. So it's really important for us to understand how this unique population forms, how it contributes to the face. But how do you do it with cells that arise at 3 to 5 weeks of gestation? Obviously, for ethical and practical considerations, it's really hard to study that type of cells. But a big breakthrough in our ability to model human development in the dish came through isolation and characterization of embryonic stem cells, or human embryonic stem cells. And I already mentioned, it's really important that we study certain developmental processes directly in human cells. And embryonic stem cells enable us that. And my lab has developed a method of deriving neural crest cells from human embryonic stem cells. And these neural crest cells recapitulate both migratory and differentiation potential of neural crest cells that we know from vertebrate organisms. So now that we can isolate these cells, we can also start studying their regulatory elements. And what we've done here is epigenomic mapping of enhancers that are active specifically in the human neural crest cells. So a few minutes ago, I explained to you how we do epigenomic mapping, how we fishing out these pieces of chromatin that are marked with active enhancer signature. We can sequence them and see where the peaks are piling up. What are the regions? Where are they? How many are there? And when we've done this analysis, we saw that over 4,000 regions were marked by active enhancer signature in these neural crest cells. And out of those, nearly 80% were unique to the neural crest cell. So we've done the analysis in parallel in several other cell types because we wanted to identify the portions of our genomes that are uniquely involved in the regulation in the crest cells. So where are these regions? We can perform so-called functional annotations, which detects associations in an unbiased way, associations with different processes that have been studied in model organisms. So for example, our human elements can be associated with genes, and we can look at mouse homologs of those genes and ask what mouse homologs of these genes are doing. And when we've done that, and I saw the results, I have to say that my neural crest-derived jaw dropped to the ground. Because the most statistically significantly enriched categories included specific categories involved in the formation of the face, but also formation of specific bones in the face that or specific structures in the face that are derived from the neural crest, such as the lower jaw, upper jaw, palate, cranial base, middle ear structures, etc., etc. So this suggested to us that by studying these very early cells, these neural crest cells that arise at 3 to 5 weeks of gestation during normal human development, we're already discovering regulatory elements that are important for making a face, and that the regulatory blueprint for making a face is established that early in development. And also, when we looked for associations with human malformations, again, the most statistically significantly enriched association included craniofacial abnormalities such as cleft lip and palate. So this really convinced us, together with some experiments that I don't have time to show you that we've done in animal models, that what we have is really relevant for how our face is put together during development. But what we can learn from this work? How can we take it further? So we can clearly learn about human development and human craniofacial development specifically, as identified enhancers provide us with unique tools to isolate and characterize discrete populations that arise in the formation of the neural crest. So I did not have time to show you the data, but we have shown in model organisms that this identified human sequences demarcate different steps in neural crest developments, such as specification at the top of the neural tube, migration, maturation, migration to specific fragments of the future face. So now we can go back and to our in vitro model and start dissecting this process even with higher resolution. We can learn about human disease as over 50 sequence variants that were previously associated with neurocrestopathies or neural crest-linked traits in those genome-wide association studies that I mentioned are located in a close proximity of the identified enhancers. So this really suggests that the hypothesis that I stated towards the beginning of my talk, huge role of regulatory mutations in diseases, is really going to prove to be true. And of course, there's a lot for us to do about it, to study the functional relationship between the enhancer mutations and the gene expression. Human evolution, again, we can study species-specific variation in the non-coding regulatory elements to understand what makes our faces human. And we would like to compare these regions that are essential for human neural crest development with those that are essential for, say, monkey neural crest development, and really understand what makes us different, what makes our faces uniquely human. And finally, ultimately, we would like to understand the role of this non-coding elements and the genetic variants of these non-coding elements in the variation in human facial features. And perhaps sometime down the road, we can understand this process so well that we will be able to predict craniofacial features simply by looking at the DNA sequence. Obviously, we're not there yet, but it's not unfeasible to think about. And with that, I would like to finish and acknowledge people that were involved. And here, I'm really just a dwarf standing on the shoulders of giants. When I was preparing this talk, I was thinking, well, I won't be able to acknowledge all the labs and all the contributions that were really necessary for us to make this progress. But what is really important is to state that this work was really made possible by decades of basic research on model organisms, and maybe not necessarily mouse that you probably most often think about, but yeast, tetrahymen, and fly were absolutely critical for our understanding of how regulatory elements work, how chromatin is organized, how our genome is packed, etc. And on the other hand, organisms like frog, fish, and chick were absolutely critical for our understanding of embryology. What is the neural crest? What is the contribution of the neural crest to the vertebrate head, etc., etc. But of course, I stress throughout my talk that looking at regulatory elements directly in human cells and directly in human development is very important. Therefore, isolation and characterization of human embryonic stem cells by Jamie Thompson and then many others made it really possible for us to mimic the developmental process in the dish. And of course, the whole field of epigenomics was made possible by the Human Genome Project and the amazing progress in the sequencing technologies that we witnessed over the last few years. And obviously, for all of this, we need public funding, and therefore, we very grateful for the public funding that basic science can receive. And for our modest contribution, I would like to acknowledge two very talented postdocs in my lab, Alvaro Rada Iglesias and Ruchi Bajpai. Ruchi actually started her own group at the University of Southern California in LA. I would also want to acknowledge Tomek Świgut for all his advice and inspiration and input into our research. This is my group, the small group of very talented young people that I'm working with. And I also want to acknowledge our funding. And in particular, California Institute for Regenerative Medicine that provided us with stable funding on the work that's related to human embryonic stem cells in the climate that has been very rocky over the last few years. And thank you very much for listening. I'll be happy to take questions.
My Polish isn't very good, but Dr. How do you pronounce your name?
Wysocka.
Wysocka. Professor Wysocka illustrates a number of important points. This is not just a free lunch. There is a reason that we schedule these. I mean, they're fascinating in their own right, these lunch seminars. But it really is important that you take the message back to your office, that there are policy implications. Now, if we can reduce the incidence of something as simple as cleft palates, or other change syndrome malformations, it improves human life enormously. I mean, we have, I have in my district, doctors who will travel around the world to perform operations on facial deformities for a few hundred people around the world, youngsters. If we can find ways to prevent those in the first place, we will be helping millions, you know, all the extended families associated with these children. So we should never forget that this is really about human welfare. Okay? So when people say, oh, stem cell, an embryonic stem cell research, how inhumane can you be? No, I would argue, how humane can we be? That's when people say, well, you know, evolution, take it or leave it, creationism or intelligent design, it doesn't really matter how that is taught in the schools. It does. It does matter. It is the kind of humane treatment that may come from this research that depends on an environment that helps us understand what, where this fits in. That there is a relationship between the evolution. Professor Wysocka, sorry.
Very good.
made an offhand comment that this cranial structure appeared late in evolution. If we didn't understand that, if we weren't able to put that in the context of evolution, it would make it much harder to investigate what they are looking at here. And furthermore, when you have Dr. Iglesias and Dr. Bajpai. I presume, this is a presumption on my part, that these two researchers were not born in the United States. We certainly know that the lead investigator was not.
Yes, they were not born. Alvaro is Spanish and Ruchi is Indian.
There are policy implications there as well. We must make it not just possible, but easy for immigrants to come here to do research, with the hope, in many cases, that they will stay and head up entire divisions at laboratories like Stanford. Important policy implications there, too. Before we, and all of these that I've mentioned, are even before we get to the question of whether the president's request of $32 billion for NIH will be honored in this year's appropriations process. $32 billion is, sounds like a lot. In the big scheme of things, it's not much. We are underinvesting in our research in the United States in almost every category. In life sciences, yes. And furthermore, and some of you have heard me make this appeal, this is called the Biomedical Caucus. All of the work about the SNPs, the polymorphisms, the SNPs that you heard about a few moments ago, I mean, that's only a couple of decades old. This requires an ongoing investment in the biological sciences, but also in the sciences that give us the people, the methodology, the instrumentation that makes it possible to recognize these things. The chemistry, the physics that comes out of the National Science Foundation, that comes out of the Department of Energy. The genomics, I mean, the Department of Energy was one of the pioneers in genomics because they had big computers, it happens. But the NIH work, this work, whether you're worried about kids around the world who have cleft palates or mental deficiencies because of the failures in the regulatory chemistry of the development, you won't deal with that. You won't be able to deal with that unless you make the investments in these supporting sciences as well. So the policy implications for your office are great from this. It's exciting work. It's fascinating in its own right. But do not fail to take back to your office the policy implications, the investments we have to make in education in the local schools, in the sustained research in NIH funding, but all of those other things that back it up that make it possible. So there are You list, Dr. Wysocka listed a number of the policy-related implications, but they go even beyond that. Don't forget it. That's why the organization gave you a bag lunch today. thanks.
Yeah, my brain hurts. I thought I had genetic testing figured out. Is this going to make genetic testing that much more complicated? Because it's not just the gene.
Yes.
Could you talk about that?
Yes. So, exactly. So, if we understand these regulatory elements, now should we be testing for mutations in regulatory elements and not just in the mutation in the gene? And of course, we should. Once we understand which alleles of regulatory elements are associated with disease, we will have to include this analysis in the genetic testing. You say it will make it more complicated. Sure. On the other hand, technology is going, it's improving so fast. The sequencing technology is improving so fast that I don't think it will be a problem. Soon it will really not be a problem to test, to include all of this in analysis. And quite frankly, I see it on the horizon that probably sequencing the full genome is going to be part of diagnostics in our lifetime.
From a clinical standpoint, is there a difference in the kind of disease you would get from a regulatory mutation versus a mutation in the gene itself?
Yeah. Regulatory, so mutations in the gene itself, particularly if it's a gene that is developmentally important, is going to affect multiple tissues and organs and is often lethal. So in fact, I think that may be a reason why we may have so many regulatory mutations contributing to the disease, because if you tinker in a major way with a coding sequence in the gene product, you're not going to survive to term. The fetus is not going to survive. But if you affect, say, enhancer that is important for expression only in the brain or only in the kidney, or only in the limb, then you will have a child born with malformations affecting this specific tissue and organ. And because other organs will not be affected, the child will likely survive the whole developmental process. But then, of course, will be born with, you know, very sometimes severe malformations. Obviously very devastating for the families and patients themselves.
And one of the things that I've studied the neural tool for my PhD, so I'm very, very, very incredibly interested in all of your work. But one of the things that I have and I've seen that I'm really concerned with, and that is that women who are in the childbearing years and they go through the airport and they get the body scan, and the child goes through and they get the body scan, I'm concerned that we radiate our children when in actuality, I think they ought to all get pat-downs. I don't really believe that the infant who is less than 3 months or a year or whatever, because what I can tell you, and I lived in Michigan for a long time and went to the University of Michigan as a faculty, we used to get brain tumors from children, and I could tell you what their address was. It was up at Dow, where Dow had their, in Midland, Michigan, always. Mm-hmm. You get a child with a brain tumor, we knew what their address was. My concern is that we're putting people through this, and I was asking someone, even in the medical field, whether or not you're really looking. They are not trained to even look at things. And there are other things that can be used. But I'm concerned about the radiation that our infants and also the neural tubes of women who don't know that they're pregnant for 9 days. That is very, 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 very troubling.
Yeah, this process happens early, yes, as I said, the beginning, yes. 3 to 5 weeks of gestation. I don't know, it's hard for me to say if those radiation doses would be relevant, of course. But we need to understand environmental influences,
correct,
during pregnancy. These are
but
very important. So for example, you know, retinoid exposure or alcohol exposure results in craniofacial defects
cigarette
in humans.
Smoke.
all there's a huge environmental impact, and the reason is that these enhancers that I talked about, there are multiple reasons, but as it relates to what I talked about, they are recognized by specific proteins that are regulated by signaling pathways. And these different environmental things or exposures can affect the way that these proteins recognize or not recognize this genomic regulatory elements, which then in turn results in the wrong or mistakes in interpretation of the genome. May not directly result in mutations, but just in the defect in interpretation. And in turn in craniofacial malformations. Yes?
I was hoping that you might speak briefly to what challenges you think lie ahead in the development of this field, and what inefficiencies may exist in the current epigenomic mapping process that you think are likely to improve in the coming years.
So I think that one, I already mentioned that there is a huge progress in the technologies. I think sequencing technologies are going to move very fast. This is not going to be a limiting step. I think current limiting step would be our availability to map these bookmarking chromatin signatures from a very small number of cells. So we still need relatively large numbers of cells to do the mapping. And perhaps if we could do it for fewer cells or even single cells, that could provide us with the ability to look at whole new sets of tissues and transient developing cell types and really get to the bottom of it with very, very high resolution. So I think, and of course, you know, hopefully the funding will enable us, and also policy as it relates to embryonic stem cells, hopefully it will stabilize in the next few years and really allow people to feel more comfortable working with those cells and making an effort in putting their talented postdocs and students into the projects that are related to research that may any day stop to be funded.
Just to clarify, were you working with NeuroQuest cells before, or how did you get so involved and interested in those cells?
So no, I haven't worked with neural crest cells before. My training is in fact as a chromatin biochemist, and I was really interested in epigenetic regulation. But neural crest cells are very unique from the epigenetic point of view as well, because they are so amazingly developmentally plastic. They make 100 different cell types. And in fact, they are very unusual in the sense that you almost can think that they gain developmental potential as they differentiate rather than lose, because they, even though they derive from the neural tube, so from cells that theoretically already committed to the, what we say, ectodermal fate, they can make all the bones and cartilage of the face, and all other bones and cartilage in our body is derived from the structure called the mesoderm. So it's very unusual that the cells that are from the neural tube make bone and cartilage, and we thought that this is really going to be, there is something unique there that we need to understand, particularly because it's so important for the craniofacial development.
I have a follow-up to your comment about funding. Mm-hmm. I'm not familiar with the California Institute of Regenerative Medicine. Is this something that's partially funded through NIH funding?
No. This is really funded by the enlightened residents of California through the so-called Proposition 71. And Californians voted to give $3 billion, if I remember correctly, over 10 years to the research that relates to the stem cells. And this has been tremendous. as I already mentioned, our research directly benefited from it. And our research is fairly basic, but there are already clinical trials that are being funded through California Institute of Regenerative Medicine. And it's really hard to underestimate how it facilitated this type of research in California and the progress of this type of research in general.
So on that note, would it be useful for the interns, those who haven't already left, because that's disappointing, here to consider the advantage that there is in constructing funding sources which ensure a stable flow of funding across a multi-year period for studies? Because I know that, particularly at NIH, particularly the current political work, there's tremendous fear for studies that we're going to be forced to end before we get data.
Yeah.
Because it acts sort of like a multi-year investment.
Yeah.
If you have a three-year study, you can't get results in 2 years.
Absolutely.
And the result is the destruction of careers of those who are.
Yeah.
I wanted to thank our presenter. I want to publicly apologize for not following the first rule of introductions, which is making sure I understand how to answer the meeting. I've learned from Rush Holt, and I'll do better next time. And I want to thank you so much for a very informative talk, and thank you all.
Thank you.